I want to thank the Open University of Lille for inviting me to make this presentation, actually inviting Bruce, who couldn't be here today, so I'm substituting for him. And I'd like to thank you all for coming here. I expect and trust this will be a very interesting discussion. I will try and limit my remarks to 45 minutes at the most, but maybe hopefully less, and we can start the discussion at that point. The article that I'll be discussing, or this article, it's a pamphlet, an essay, is called Contemporary Capitalism and Why We Need Marxism. You can download it. It should be in the flyer you have with you to where you can download it from. Down from nothing, actually. I hope that this discussion will lead you to do that, because although it's reasonably short, it's fairly dense. It's not a popularization view. It's not a view that, it's not a thing that can appeal to new people coming to politics or that they can understand. It's something that is fairly, as I said, fairly dense, and involves, I think, a fair amount of experience with these ideas, although of course we hope some young people are influenced by it. As the introducer mentioned, the pamphlet or the essay basically argues that a Marxist material analysis is fundamental to understanding and articulating the recent international social economic conjecture. We sketch in this pamphlet the key phenomenon defining our area and draw some general strategic conclusions on what the political approach and tasks of revolutionary Marxists should be currently focusing on. To do this, all this in a relatively short essay necessitates a necessarily cryptic and schematic presentation. But we felt this was worth doing in view of the absence of such analysis among Marxist activists. There are a number of worthy, lengthy, and more detailed treatises written by scholars and academics, some of the most relevant which we reference in this article. But unfortunately, these works are often very theoretically dense and do not find their way to left activists, the primary intended audience of ours. The essay is not intended as a popularization or easy readings, but we hope its brevity will tempt activists to give it a go. Further, the essay is not meant to settle complex questions, but to raise them. The hope for response is to initiate a vigorous and rigorous debate on Marxism within activist circles. Such a debate is a necessary preliminary to a revival of a working class social Marxist movement, which in turn is a prerequisite for successful movement of social and political emancipation. Most U.S. left activists are now naturally absorbed in discussing the meaning and course of action to take in regard to the 2016 presidential election and its immediate aftermath. While our essay does not address this in detail, it does offer a strategic perspective from which to approach this question. We are concerned about the failure of most proposals to be anchored in an in-depth analysis of the basic dynamics of contemporary capitalism. Many of the proposals, whether they suggest long-term rejection of any alliance with liberals and place split from the Democratic Party, or short-term coalition with liberal Democrats to defeat Trumpism, these are two sort of views, appear to be based on long-held politics and slogans which do not seem to take into account the profound developments in international capitalism that have occurred over the past 40 years. We think this is a serious mistake which results from the neglect of a rigorous Marxist approach, and is exactly what we argue against in this essay. Of course, we welcome serious responses and criticisms of our essay. The best way to reach us is via email, which is on your on the flyer which we've given out. And we will respond to them, the serious responses, in a timely manner, as far as. Okay, now, let's begin with some theoretical considerations of what a Marxist material analysis involves. Marx's definition of materialism, of capitalism, is a form, capitalism is a form of appropriation of social value through the commodification of all wealth and through active to private owners of the means of production. Wealth here being socially useful, necessary resources, or which form the basis of human civilization, human life. The Marxist economic theories of values, the basic categories are surplus value, surplus value, and which define the capitalist system, and which distinguish advanced capitalism and set prices and profits. This leads to the politically fundamental concept of the exploitation, and particularly of the working class. These notions in Marxism are based on the notion of value, surplus, and surplus value. And if you don't understand what these are, then there's all sorts of, I think, fundamentally superficial and non-scientific notions of exploitation and the working class. The exploitation is rooted in the surplus value, that is the value that is produced by workers and appropriated by the owners of the means of production, the capitalists. This hasn't changed since the origin of capitalism, and it was Marx's great insight into the foundations of capitalism. Exploitation, as they say, is also the underlying economic basis of imperialism. And as a world organization, which is dominated by the leading capitalist powers. So those are the fundamental, Marx didn't deal directly with imperialism, but the evaluation and the elaboration of the notion of imperialism. I mean, Marx dealt with some notion of imperialism, but this was developed by later Marxist thinkers in the early part of the 20th century. And this is, again, one of the fundamental, has become one of the fundamental insights of Marxism, and has to be elaborated. The notion of imperialism has, in fact, led to the notion of super-exploitation, which is rooted in surplus value. And exploitation, of super-exploitation, involves the share of the workers, the value created by workers, the decreasing share of value created by the working class, which goes to the working class, and which is, in fact, goes in such a way that the worker's standard of living, or the worker's livelihood, diminishes as the capitalist appropriates the fruits of the labor. And so that super-exploitation is, in fact, the characteristic economic aspect of imperialism. And the that's classical Marxism, or early 20th century Marxism. However, the notions of imperialism, the analysis of imperialism, has been modified in certain ways under certain current conditions. And what we have to do is understand the dynamics of contemporary imperialism, what has affected them, and how they are somewhat different from the dynamics of the imperialism of the late 19th and early 20th century. Now, to do that, we have to understand the transformation of technology and the labor and the relations of production. Technological transformations have occurred fundamentally under capitalism. They occurred at the beginning of the 20th century and the end of the 19th century with the formation of large corporations and the sort of individual ownership of factories into the corporate culture and the corporate development. This was a development that occurred at the beginning of the 20th century and changed the conditions under which labor, the relations of production, because it changed the form, nature of surplus value and exploitation. We don't dwell on this in this pamphlet, but it's understood by most and accepted by most, and it was the basis of, for example, the trade union theories and the theories of the trade unions as a fundamental organization of the working class was rooted in the change of relationships that occur toward the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th century. The technology, however, there's been another technology transformation that has occurred over the last 50 years. And that is the transformation, that is the invention of information technology and the development of information technology and robotics and other forms of producing products and wealth. And that's a fundamental change in the sense that it changes relations of production. So the industrial worker class has been, in most countries, the most advanced Western countries, has been their conditions have deteriorated under the conditions of the new technology, and which a lot of the productive activities which they engaged in are now taken over by this new technology. And it also made possible, this new technology made possible the development of the financial side of capitalism, which we see triumphant today, and which meant instant information that could be communicated over vast distances, and the speculation and financial speculation that this made possible, and the rule of finance capital. So that these are all the results of this technological transformation that has occurred over the past 50 years. And this in turn has led to a change in the nation of a nature of imperialism a bit. In one hand, it's led to an economic change in that the role of imperialism is not to so much extract raw material resources. So it still, of course, does that, but it's now has changed somewhat. It's now become much more the exploitation of workers in third world countries and the ex-colonies as laborers, the direct exploitation by the lowering of wages, the reduction of wages, and the fact that now they can produce the goods that used to be produced or would otherwise produce in the advanced capitalist nations, they can produce them in China and India and other places at a much lower cost, wage cost. And that means the super exploitation has been extended and made into a world system And surplus value, in that sense, that's increased surplus value. But on the other hand, that has also decreased surplus value, since surplus value is also a function of the amount of human labor involved, the necessary labor costs of producing, the difference between the necessary labor costs and the income of the amount of value appropriated by the capitalists. And with the new technology, in many respects, in many areas of the world, particularly in the advanced capitalist country, the question of the demand for labor has decreased. The labor that's directly productive has decreased. Informal economies have begun to rule, where people work hazardous informal jobs with no security. And of course, in the major cities of the third world, in Mumbai or Beijing, you have vast numbers of people who, or in or Rio, you have vast numbers, not so much in Beijing maybe, but you have vast numbers of impoverished millions and hundreds of millions of people who used to work the land and created value, although they were peasants, they were different from factory workers, and now are stuck in trying to scrape out a living, hustling and in the large ghettos and slums and favelas of these cities. And this has been change on a world basis, relations of production fundamentally. But it's not only the third world that has changed it, it's changed it in the advanced capitalist centers, where there are now huge slums and people dispossessed of even in small towns, dispossessed of their labor, of their opportunity to create value and to be part of the labor force on any permanent or secure basis. So this technology is important, and it has changed the nature of imperialism and the nature of, and then therefore changed the necessary nature of capitalism, which depended on and still depends on imperialism to assure its profits. So let me mention a little bit about, so that's the new reality of our time. Let me mention a little bit about its application to an issue that's on everybody's mind, a social question, and that's imperialism and the environmental crisis. We, as all, I think, legitimate scientific opinion is in accord that we face an environmental crisis, that the pollution, the global warming has put, not maybe put human existence at stake, but it's going to transform human existence much for the worse over the next 30 or 40 years unless something is done about it. Some changes are made, less use of fossil fuels, for example, being the most important one. Now, we're facing an environmental catastrophe. Now, how is this tied in with capitalism? Well, on the one hand, the major energy companies, corporations, oil and natural gas and others, including agricultural corporations and big chem agriculture, have of course a very vested interest in not limiting the use of fossil fuels, because there are estimated $20 trillion worth of fossil fuels that have still lie in the ground, and the claim that money that from them is going to go primarily to the big high energy companies and the energy investors and the frackers and stuff like that, and they obviously are not going to surrender $20 trillion simply because of an environmental crisis. In fact, they know full well, and it's true, that the ruling class and the upper elements will survive a climate crisis. They'll build dwellings and pollution-free places on mountaintops, and they'll survive the climate crisis, but the mass of working people, of course, will suffer greatly from that. So that's, I think, our comments on what's happening with the with technology, the transformation of technology, and super exploitation, both of workers and of the technology that is now able to secure and access sources of energy that didn't happen before. What does this mean for our relations with imperialism? I think that a Marxist position nowadays has to revise its conception of imperialism and to find new strategies to fight it. Imperialism is still an intrinsic center aspect of capitalism, but its form is somewhat different. For one thing, in the 20th century, the main struggle against imperialism was the national liberation movements, the anti-colonial movements in the Third World, in the exploited countries. And the main duties of Marxists and of people who wanted to make changes was to support those struggles. Those struggles, of course, still continue, but they've taken a different form now. The struggle against colonialism, which is a struggle for national independence and sovereign governments run by people from the region rather than direct administration by the wealthy imperialist states, that's gone by and large. There's some colonies still left, but by and large, neo-colonies, the subject of imperialism now, are run by the political systems, are run by their local ruling class who have forged an alliance with the international capitalists. And the international capitalists' role is now to keep those ruling classes in power. And that's the foundation of the military strategies pursued by the United States as a primary military capitalist power in the world, and secondarily by the advanced capitalist countries in Europe, that their role is, and their necessity of these regimes, of our capitalist regimes, is to keep in power that layer of the foreign ruling class. For example, almost comical example is the Saudi rulings, princes and stuff like that, keep them in power, keep them able to open up the exploitation, to work with the exploitation of the natural resources that are in that country. And that changes the nature of the tasks of the left. Our focus can no longer be anti-imperialist, anti-colonial movements which are involved in the national liberation and nationalism, so-called progressive revolutionary nationalism, which is now takes the form, there is a nationalist rejection in those countries, now taking the ruling strata, and now taking the force foremost extremely of the Islamist movement. They are, after all, in some sense, a nationalist movement, ISIL and those people, who want to get rid of foreign control of their countries. But our role is not to support those people for that purpose, because their politics is in fact basically reactionary. And so the political context has changed. At the same time, the left in this country, the Marxist left and the organized left, hasn't really changed its line on imperialism. It still tends to view people like Assad as an ally, because he's in some sense a nationalist, he is, whereas the reality of imperialism now and the reality of the struggle that are going on in the neo-colonies is no longer the same kind of national struggle. So this is a question of reevaluation by Marxists of the national international conjuncture and what our tasks are now. And without such an international, without such a reevaluation, what we have is massive confusion on the part of so-called anti-war forces in the United States. Some of them, if any of you are on the UFPJ list, for example, United for Peace and Justice, the largest kind of left anti-war organization, some of them people are virulently supporting Assad, and the other half are severely supporting his people are trying to overthrow him. Well, neither one of those positions is a position that makes sense in the present international conjuncture. But the refusal of Marxist groups to give up ancient doctrine and ancient slogans is become a barrier for building a viable anti-imperialist movement. Now the main, and here's where I think I'm going to stop, the main political point of our essay is that there can't be a socialist movement without a working organized working class in the center of it. This is Marx's discovery, and it's right. It remains true today that without the working class organized in a movement for socialism and an anti-capitalist movement for socialism, and having become a force, there is no other force out there in the advanced capitalist countries or in the neo-colonies, the backwards so-called, underdevelopment. There is no other force out there other than a working class and that can transform the system, that can challenge the rule of capital. And in our country, to talk to our, this means that the left has to find ways to reconnect with the working class. This connection has been lost. It was built in the 20s and 30s when we had an adequate conception of capitalist industry and what it involved. And when we had a socialist world bloc, or at least a socialist state, the Soviet Union, which, with all its mistakes and errors, tried to uphold Marxism and the rule of the working class. This has been lost now. There is no, I mean, there are socialist countries like Cuba, and they should be supported, but they're small, and they don't exercise any influence on the working class in the United States anymore. That means that we have to find a new basis for organizing workers in their present situation. And I want to remind you that workers are defined in the capitalists by people for whom the value of what they do, the social value of what they do, is appropriated by capitalists. They're not defined, while industrial workers and truck drivers and longshoremen and miners were the sort of core of the working class 60 years ago, it's not necessarily true anymore, and it's not going to be. It's not that we should ignore that layer of the working class, but the people who are performing value in terms of social services, in terms of health, in terms of education, have become as crucial to the struggle as the industrial workers. And this is indicated by what are the two most radical unions in Chicago? The teachers' union and the nurses' union. No other union in the city of Chicago can compare with them in challenging the system. There's a reason for that. It's not just they have, were lucky and got good leadership. It's that the conditions of labor have changed and that the industrial unions are no longer in a position to exercise the kind of leadership because the conditions of the labor of their workers have changed. And until we face up to that, then we're not going to be able to build a movement of workers to challenge capitalism. And the politics of that are independent workers' organizations and workers' agendas, workers' platforms that deal with the direct condition of the workers. This presents a problem because there is no, none of them, neither one of the major parties, for example, qualifies as this and will suffice as this, and whether, you know, Trump is worse than Clinton, well, maybe he is, and there's reasons why we would rather have Clinton win than Trump. I don't want to get into that argument, but the fact is that whoever wins, it's not going to help our politics and build the kind of movement that we all, most of us, are committed to. And that the, in fact, I really expect, I'm not sure Bruce agrees with this as much, but I really expect after the election to be a new wave of right, whoever wins, will be a new wave of right, of reaction, of law and order and pro-police things that will, in fact, there will be a new wave of reaction that will sweep over this country, and we're going to have to fight that. It's going to be very, very ugly the next few years, no matter who wins. And we can't expect anything much out of Congress or the established political establishment to do anything good. That means you have to build a workers' movement which has an independent politics, which has its own platform, and its own sense of class, its own desire for class power. How you do that, we don't know. That's very difficult. It's very difficult. A lot of us leftists are older, veterans who cannot play a key organizational role anymore. We're too old, we're too tired, but there are young radicals around, particularly in the Black Lives Matter movement, for example, and in other circles. The fact that Bernie Sanders got a lot of support among college students shows there is potential for young people to be brought into such a movement if they understand the need for a workers-based movement. And that's the dangers we face, that young radicals may not understand. The Occupy movement, for example, didn't understand the need of an organized working class. And it faded away. So that is the dangers, the possibilities, and the opportunities for us in the future. And I'm going to stop talking now. You want me to moderate this? You want to moderate?
The questions are going to be addressed to you. Just respond to that. Yeah.
Yeah, so, we have roughly an hour, not quite, but we have ample time here for people to talk. The only thing that I would suggest is that we all tend to fall in love with this thing when we get up here now, don't we? I'm looking at a few particular people here, but anyway, just try to hold your comments to, you know, reasonable length, you know, or questions, a couple of minutes, and give our presenter a chance to, respond. So I'm not even going to ask a question at this point. I've got some things I'm working on in my head, but by all means, let's get up here and get going.
Be a very short question. What role do you think the international labor movement and, as a sub-category, the American labor movement can play in this?
Well, if by the labor movement you mean the organized, recognized trade unions, they have a problem. But I think, for example, internationally, the working class, and it's not only working class in the United States, but the working class in China and India will play a crucial role. And we've seen working class activity in China and some in India, not as much, We've seen kind of left working class activity in Latin America, although that's gone through a period of a shaky period at this time. We have Europe going through a real crisis, political crisis, which may give rise to working class activity, although the danger there is that the right will capture it. But certainly the progressive trade unions will play a role, even in America, although I think that we can't count on them to be the leadership and to develop the strategy. I think that they will respond to their own workers when their workers are responding to a more radical and platform and set of demands. I don't think that's all with them, though. That's the issue.
I read an article by a European Marxist. I want to say it was Boris Karkulitsky, but I'm not sure. And he argued that when you looked at the American presidential election, you shouldn't really concentrate on the personalities, as people are wont to do, but rather look on who's backing them. He made the argument that Clinton was basically the candidate of the financial wing of the bourgeoisie, where Trump represented a different wing of the bourgeoisie, perhaps more small businesses, commercial, and so on, who weren't benefiting, in fact, were hurt by policies that helped, you know, big capital, big finance. I wondered if you could comment on that, whether you see any of that in terms of the sort of different wings of the bourgeoisie supporting different candidates, not only in this election, but in general.
I don't think much of the ruling class is supporting Trump, actually. I think that they would rather not have him. They don't want him in there. But where his support is coming from, I think, is basically his popular support is coming from a section of the lower middle class that has been hurt by the economic policies over the past 20 years, globalization, neoliberalism, financial shenanigans and things like that, and are pissed off that they have lost their status in American life. Part of it is racist and anti-immigrant, and too, that the white people are used to be the kings of the hill and they're no longer. So that's where the popular support is coming from. I think that my own feeling is that the ruling bourgeoisie does not want him in power because he's too erratic and unstable, and are basically opposed to him, including Wall Street and the major industrial corporations and stuff like that. They haven't, including the media. I mean, they've not treated him. They've given him attention because he's kind of sensationalistic, but they also spent a lot of time giving people who attack him, airtime also, and he's looking ridiculous sort of now, or they think he's looking ridiculous as losing a chance of winning. So I don't think that there's any real section of the bourgeoisie that's supporting him, any significant section. There's individuals, but not the significant section.
Thank you for your talk, Doctor. Trying to spare the audience my usual lecture about how the major institutions in the society do the opposite of what they say they're supposed to do, and how the educational institution doesn't teach critical thinking, it teaches obedience, and that the medical institution health is a side effect of when you go to the doctor, the main effect is that somebody pays for your appointment. And on with all the other major institutions, be they politics or church or whatever you want to name. But going along with that, I've noticed that we've got this tendency, at least in this country, particularly since there was no union movement to oppose it, of privatization. And the one of the big problems with privatization, although there are many, privatizing the labor and the delivery of services in the, for these institutions that used to be paid for by the government, is so then you get a constituency of private contractors who not only they're taking prisons, for example, not only does the treatment of prisoners fall under the the aegis of trying to cut costs as much as possible, but recently one of the biggest opponents of marijuana legalization is the organization, it's not a union, but the organization of prison workers of thank you. And this becomes an outgrowth of the privatization. It's my personal theory that, if you'll pardon the cliche of the chickens coming home to roost, that since we don't produce anything in this country, that the corporate ruling elite have taken over these formerly nonprofit institutions, formerly provided and run by the government, and they're extracting value by becoming a private contractor where the ruling elite can get a return on its investment. When I was a young person, you couldn't invest in prisons, you couldn't invest in companies that provided education, only textbooks, you couldn't invest in people who provided services for the military, you could only invest in weapons makers, but now you can invest in entire all-in-one providers of services to these major institutions and get a return on your investment. That's where our tax dollars go, aside from all the other waste and war. So I'd like you to comment on, I'm trying to get at the idea that since there's no production to extract surplus value in anymore, that it has to, that the profit motive has to prey on these formerly nonprofit service institutions that used to be run by the government.
It's important to remember that traditionally, and this is one of the problems of preserving traditional Marxism, is early 20th century market is generally seen in material objects. And of course, we're producing in this country less material objects, and that's been shipped overseas, a lot of it, industrial manufacturing, things like that. But value to Marx was, and I think is right, is not just material products, but that's part of it, but also services and things that humanity needs to exist, basic things, and including health, education, and other sort of non-material goods. That's also value being produced. And I think that it's not true that we're not producing any value if you take into a broader notion of value. What we're producing is less kind of hard industrial goods that we used to produce. And this has been shipped abroad to take advantage of cheap labor. So now what you mentioned was part of the dynamics of capitalism is the tendency to commodify all goods. And what happened is, of course, that education, healthcare, these things, social services, are being commodified by, and the people who are doing them, the teachers or the nurses or healthcare, are still the same workers that worked under capitalism, but the management and ownership of these, of their equipment and their facilities has been turned over to capitalist hands and turned into commodities that they can make a profit off of. And this is true, and this is generally an amazing, a massive problem in this country, and to some extent in the rest of the developed world, and that a workers' program would fight this. That's one of the things that a program built around an organized workers' movement would do battle with. For example, in the case of schools, the part of the dynamic of this is that It breaks the teachers' unions. It puts teachers in a weaker position of bargaining position. And it also leads, much of this privatization is also leads to the enrichment not only of the capitalists, but also of the political machines that use this privatization as a way of raising funds for campaign funds. You can, and this is obvious in the city of Chicago, is a very crude example where the mayor, Rahm, collects millions of dollars in campaign contributions from people who get government work, and who have profits off of privatization of schools and things of that sort, and social benefits. So that it's not only, it's a political issue too. It's a very sharp political issue that until you get an administration and politicians in there who are responsible to working class interests, and this can only happen with a working class movement, a movement like the core movement, that this will continue. That they will argue, and they continue, that it's less expensive for the public purse, for less tax dollars, than doing the privatization. And to some extent, this is true. There's less tax dollars, but of course, there's worse services, and there's where the remaining tax dollars go is into the hands of the capitalists who take over these institutions.
All right, I'm ready to blavate here for a couple of minutes.
You know, our last guest about a month ago, we had a young man here who was an activist, Vincent Emanuele. Very interesting guy. You know, he was in the Marine Corps. He served two tours of duty. He was in Iraq and as well as Afghanistan. I mean, getting away from myself here for a moment. But you know, he came forward. His thesis is essentially like, we better get organized, and I second that, and we better get organized real fast, because I think we're kind of like, and when I say we, I mean in the broadest sense, our population is kind of sleepwalking into the abyss here, and I, in all of my years on the planet, I will honestly say, and you can tell I'm pretty old, but you know, I go back to a time when you know, we were duck and cover in grade school, and the idea being that you know, nuclear war was imminent with the Russians, of course, and it's like we've come full circle, I feel like, right now, because I think that's what we're looking at going forward. I'm really, really concerned. I don't want to get too much into elections and stuff, but I've always said, even before you know, this thing was played out in the primaries, that, you know, the next president was going to be Hillary Clinton, and Hillary Clinton is a dangerous woman. She's a dangerous woman because she's got a thing about the Russians, and I think that a lot of our misleadership, if you will, militarism that exists, and you address these questions regarding imperialism, are really front and center with us right now. And getting back to my point that the movement basically doesn't exist. I mean, it's not, nothing is happening right now. And if anything, it's like screaming at us that we've got to get organized. I mean, that means getting out in the streets again and doing things that, like, people seemingly have no interest or perhaps just don't believe that they can really be effective any longer. But here's the thing. I mean, I ask yourself this question, and this is one that I thought was my biggest takeaway from our last presenter. And again, he just briefly outlined who he was and his what he thought. But if you think about it, I mean, if we do nothing, if we stay as we are, we're going to be in, I mean, it's the only thing that could be worse than what's happening right now is if we just basically continue to sit on our hands. And I just want you to comment on that. I mean, I identify as a Marxist. I mean, I think economics are extremely, I mean, right at the top of the list. But we need as broad a perspective to bring to this problem, if you will, as possible. And that also entails looking at the sociological aspects. I mean, we know this country is, we've had other programs here most recently regarding, with Black Lives Matter, racism, this, you know, this seeming sickness that permeates our culture, obviously economics, politics. It's the answers are not, there's not a simple answer, but on the other hand, I mean, it's pretty evident that we have to get going. We have to get off of our backsides and do something, because the options are just unthinkable. I mean, that's how dangerous I think things are right now. I'll just, you can comment on that. I'll leave it at that grim point.
I agree. This is not working.
No, you're okay. Yeah, you're okay.
I agree that things are dangerous.
No, it's not.
Your switch.
I agree that things are dangerous now, and that there's dangers of expanding military action. I think I don't think the actual war with Russia is on the agenda, because that would be suicidal. I mean, and I don't think that there's any plans for that, although Putin can be demonized and Russia can be blamed, that's a good scapegoat, but they're not, you know, I don't think there's any war with Russia on the agenda. What is possible, and which is likely under Clinton and probably under Trump also, is expansion of American military activity in the Middle East. That's very, very dangerous because of the direction of movement there that's happening. The reason for that is not so, it's economics, in the sense that we want to preserve, the ruling class wants to preserve access to and control of the oil that comes out of there. It's the oil source of much of the oil in the world. Economically, but also politically, it's a very, very important thing, because this is a center of imperialist power, the Middle East, and they run it by and large, even though there's some opposition, and if that should disappear, then it would unleash a vast movement in the Middle East for social justice, I believe. I mean, as we saw that in the Arab Spring. And should that happen, then there would be a real challenge to imperialism in that part of the world. So I think that the reason for the military buildup is to stop that from happening, to support Egypt and support Saudi Arabia and other regimes that are, you know, that are explicitly and counter-revolutionary and counter-reformist. In a sense, and here I think there is a difference between, say, Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama. I think that he wanted to wind down American troop involvement in the Middle East, in Iraq, and probably in Afghanistan, because he thought, maybe he still thinks, that you could use diplomatic and economic levers to accomplish the same purpose, and the military involvement was unpopular and counterproductive. I don't think Hillary thinks that way. I think she's prepared to increase military involvement in the Middle East, and with that, that increases the danger that you mentioned, the danger of a spreading and of conflict there, which will put the American ruling class, the government, up against the wall. They'll have to escalate their involvement as the resistance increases, and what forms that will take, we don't, you know, we can only imagine. It's horrible. So it's very, very dangerous. I agree with you there. But I think the basic driving force there is more political and political power of U.S. and Western capitalism in the Middle East, which is being challenged. It was challenged, started, the challenge started with the with the, you know, the spring, the Egyptian uprising and the Arab Spring, and is now increasing more. That's my view of it.
I'm back. I'm going to go somewhere else now. We agree to disagree. I didn't mean to imply that I think that, like, for example, she's crazy and she's hell-bent on starting World War III. But you yourself did say, you know, that the way these things can play out is the kind of like the law of unintended consequences, you know. Somebody ups the ante over here, and then there's a counter-reaction, and the next thing you know, we're all dead. But I want to leave that alone now. Let's get back on the question about economics. I'm curious about your thoughts about, and I'm referencing here one of the arguments that's been made with regards to, I'm talking about the U.S. economy specifically now, not so much looking at this as a international question. I mean, it all does play into that, of course, but a problem that it strikes me that what we're looking at right now, for lack of a better word, and I'm trying to think of who was brought this term forward, a demand deficit. What we have is a situation where those, and half of our industrial labor force is definitely gone. I mean, that's an objective fact. We've lost half of those jobs over the last 30, 35 years. But given what we still have that's in place, I mean, if you look at the conditions, again, of the, let's just say the average American worker, he's really up against it right now. I mean, not only has his, you know, the surplus value has been extracted out of him and, like, you know, just left on the heap over here. The fact being, however, that, like, most of the money that, and you look at the average American worker, and I would posit that, like, the biggest problem that they have is that they basically, they're broke, for lack of a better term. They can't pay for the things that they basically need. I mean, a humongous percentage, when you look at their rents, I mean, their fixed costs, they're so high. What's left over to buy, even the stuff that they make? You know, I'm overgeneralizing again here, of course, but this is making the point that how can we possibly fix this? The only thing that I can conceive of, and again, I'm talking here more like structurally, is that, like, this debt that the average American finds himself in, the one and only answer that presents itself is that, and I don't see how this can be done politically, because the ruling class would never go along with this idea, but would be like a, you know, there's an old term, a debt jubilee. In other words, where there would be a forgiveness. Maybe that's a political argument that needs to be made that I don't see anybody bringing forward, which is to say, it's impossible. The average worker is so underwater, he can't get back to even, can't even get on dry land anymore. What can we do? You know, what's a potential argument that can be made that, as an organizing point, if you will? I'll just leave it at that.
Okay. Well, under capitalism, there's only so much you can do, but there are, it's not true there isn't things you can't do. For example, student debt can be forgiven. I mean, the banks and the financial institutions that loan students that money can take a haircut. I mean, they're not going to collapse because of it, but it would relieve the pressure on especially working class students who get through college with a lot of big debt, have trouble finding a job, or can't take the job they get where they want, and they have to pay off the debt. The same thing is true on credit card debt. That the laws can be put in place that limit how much you can that the, how much that can be. I mean, you can't simply, the crown of the credit card companies can charge you what they want for a late payment. And most working people are in debt to credit card companies, one way or the other. So there are demands that can be made, which means, the demands would mean that a section of the capitalist class, and particularly the financial industry, will give up a source of its profits, will have to be forced to, without giving everything up, but they'll be forced to give up a source of its profits, which are enormous now. I mean, they're the most profitable industries in the United States. There's no reason why somebody who makes $1 billion a year pays no taxes. I mean, you can take half of that away from them. And they'll still be motivated to make $500 million a year. So there is a number of concrete things that can be done to improve the immediate conditions of the working class, but not, they won't solve the problem, they'll just ameliorate them to some extent. And a working class movement that existed, and a political movement that existed, would be making those demands and would be organizing people around that. But there's nobody doing that now. I mean, you know, I mean, including the labor unions. They won't attack the financial industry.
That's my point.
And until that happens, that people are going to get squeezed more and more. I mean, there's no force against it. And the dynamics of capitalism are, well, if you can make more profit, you make more profit anywhere you can. So, but I don't think that it's hopeless, even short of, you know, full-bred socialism. I think in the long run, you have to look towards socialism, because any of these ameliorating effects, to be sure the capitalists will organize against them and overcome them eventually, as we did. I mean, during the 30s, there were certain things done under the New Deal that the capitalists didn't like, but they liquidated that pretty much now. And so I think that you have to, you know, you organize around the socialists. You have to look towards the socialist goal. But you have to also, but you also can organize work. But the trouble is, no one's doing it.
My question is about implementation, and that's the hard part. It is very unlikely that capitalists will volunteer giving a small fraction of their profits and bonuses. Movements that we have now are very compartmentalized. The culture of individualism, greed, and the American dream is still dominant in I would say, most of our, the back of our mind and the front. So how do we get from here to change the system to do this, to redistribute ownership, to change the culture, because without changing the way we think about relations, not just labor relations, but all human relations, it's not going to work. How do we get to a revolution? It will take a revolution, unless you see another way to get there. When a culture of fear, when the capitalistic system holds us all captive, either economically or by factors of fear, psychologically, and they can maintain and replicate this culture all the time because they own all the advertisement, PR, and media. So what is your concepts, or what are you thinking as far as how do we get there, or halfway?
Well, I got my start in politics through the civil rights movement. 50 years ago or so, the black people couldn't live in certain neighborhoods, they couldn't get mortgages, there were forced segregation, there was lynch mobs, and the things did change. Now, that doesn't, they're not emancipated, they're still suffering police brutality and other social evils. But the civil rights movement was an organized movement which struggled and fought for change, and forced change by, you know, closing, shutting down Washington, or threatening to shut down Washington, and shutting down normal operations, and generating, you know, revolutionaries, although the revolutionaries didn't succeed, the Black Panthers were wiped away, but that spirit that was in there, and that moved and animated Black youth at that time, forced the change, and forced to some change. In particular, what happened is that they created, they coped with it by creating a Black middle class. That was the solution to the problem of discrimination against Blacks, was that there was Michelle Obama's family went up in the world, and she got to go to the university, okay? I mean, that, due to Harvard, where she went, the solution was creating a Black middle class. The Black movement failed to carry through, and the radicals were outmaneuvered, and that's what happened. Sad, but change did occur, just as the labor movement generated change in the 30s through organizing and mobilizing. So you can get change in culture, and it's involved change in culture too. I mean, a mixed couple, most white Americans frowned on mixed marriages, disapproved of them 50 years ago. Now it's routine. Only the racists frown on them now. Most Americans 100 years ago weren't pro-union, they were anti-union. But by the 30s, things changed. The culture, anti-union culture, was altered by the struggle of the working class to form unions. It was a struggle, and it was a battle, and you were able to create so much, enough trouble and problems that people had to rethink their prejudice in some sense and to change their view of the world. And I think that that's what we need now. That by itself won't lead to, causing trouble just won't, by itself doesn't lead to socialism, and we need more than that to do that. But I think mass mobilization is the key to, is the key to making any immediate change. And we have to, we have to figure out a way to do that, particularly mobilizing the working class.
Thank you. First of all, I think that your presentation have been very clear, and your positions presented in a way that they are easily understood. I want to present a view that humanity is a virus to the earth that doesn't deserve anymore to give it the credit of this progress or that progress here or there. We throw 90,000 pounds of plastic shit into the sea every day. The people in the Amazon River have been dying from mercury left from the extraction of gold by the British at the beginning of the Industrial Revolution. Whatever humans touch, death follows. We are brutal against each other. We are brutal against our environment. We have no redeeming actions that justify this little progress. So now we tolerate a mixed couple to marry. What the hell that means compared to the destruction that goes day to day after day after day? The nuclear issue, besides the bombs, it's a nuclear cycle where radioactive materials are extracted from the earth. They're extracted in South America, in Africa, and wherever it's done, the water and the land is contaminated with leftover from radioactive materials. But here in the United States, we do more. We dump the leftovers on Navajo Reservation, where the kids have to play and so on. So the waters, the rivers, the lakes, and all that contaminate with radioactive materials that have half-lives of 90,000 years or 100,000 or millions of years. We are a destructive creature, and we are not confronting that. And so all this progress that is saying because of we becoming more or less active against social progress by one sector of another is on the background that we are really going straight to down to hell because we have more nuclear bombs, more destructive. More destructive technologies to fight each other. And then there is the other thing that a mathematician at the University of Chicago calculated the probabilities of nuclear disasters by means of how many of these weapons and these plants are working, and you know about Chernobyl and Fukushima. And these things are still going on. Fukushima is still leaking radioactive waste in all the seas. And so where are we going from here? We are not recognizing that we are a destructive force. And I don't see any political, whether the left or the right or anything, to recognize how brutal we are.
I would consider that these things as a result of capitalism, and we have to get into that more. I unfortunately have to leave. My ride has to go, and
well, I thought you were going to go till 4:30. Till 4:30 is fine with me.
Yeah, we're okay.
Yeah, five more minutes then. Okay. So if someone, I mean, I agree that I think that these things you mentioned are results of capitalism and capitalist appropriation of all the resources without the concerning consequences, and a commodification of all natural goods, and they will continue until capitalism is finished. I mean, there's no solution. I'm not very optimistic about any kind of climate control or environmental control of significant being established because. The people who run the world and run our society won't suffer as much. They will live in their sheltered places, and their water will be clean, and they'll be able to swim in their private pools or beachfronts. And the rest of us, who will suffer, our children, our grandchildren, will suffer from these conditions. Will have no real say in. So I'm not really very confident that there's going to be much of a change in that respect until capitalism itself is challenged. And we need to do that. I think the environmental movement has to become more of a anti-capitalist movement. It's become to some extent, but it has to become more of an anti-imperialist movement, an anti-capitalist movement. And it also has to begin to appeal more to working people. Again, I think a number of working people in sections of working communities have been devastated, even in Chicago, by pollution and by waste. But it's not a fundamental issue for most working people. They have other things on their mind about earning a living and providing for their families. And how do you make it an issue? You mobilize and organize people. That's the only way you can do it, and we have to figure out a way to do that, somebody has to figure out a way to do it. All of us, I think, can play a role. I would invite all of you to pick up one of these flyers and download this pamphlet, and if you have more questions or comments, to email me or Bruce, and we'll take them up. I don't think we have all the answers here. I'm just raising some questions and possibilities. And it's people like you who have to be critical and think of it. You know, you're all experienced, veteran, political activists. You've got to think about these things and see what to do. That would be a big step forward. Beyond that, we have to be able to reach out to younger people who are capable of doing the kind of organizing work that I'm not capable of doing anymore. I'm too old. But you know, we went through a movement in the 60s, 70s. I went through a movement. A lot of you here, I think, went through the same movement, in which, as activists, we were thought of ourselves as revolutionaries. We were going to change the world. We didn't succeed, but we did affect things. We ended the war in Vietnam. We were partially responsible for doing that. We were partially responsible for any civil rights gains that were made. We were partially responsible for any gains for women that were made, because we challenged the system. And the same kind of people like us, but younger and newer, have to take up these issues and organize around them. And I think the basic insight that Marx has is the role of the working class. In fact, that it's very, very crucial that Brits develop within the, or establish within the working class around this sort of stuff. It's not, you know, the left says, let's unify the left. I don't think that's the crucial thing. I think the crucial thing is to unify the working class, or to organize the working class. Insofar as the united left can do it better than the split left, sure. But I don't think that our organizations, by coming together on themselves and splitting the differences and stuff like that, is a crucial thing. The crucial thing is that we be able to reach out to people who, some of them are supporting Trump now, and people who are concerned with the economic costs and social economic costs of capitalism, but don't know that yet. That they don't know that it's capitalism that's their problem. They think it's big government. They think it's maybe rich people. And they think it's immigrants. Whatever they blame their problems on, they don't have the right target in mind. The key organizing role is to be able to bring that issue to mass of the people, and particularly the working class. So I have to leave now. My ride is going. But I thank you all for inviting me. We had an interesting discussion. I appreciate the points that were made. I think they were good points. There wasn't as much disagreement with me as I thought there would be, but that's okay. I mean, that's better yet. So anyhow, download the pamphlet, read it, send me your comments, or Bruce your comments, your criticisms on it, and that will be, I think, helpful to us and help to spread some of these ideas that I need to be spread.
I think your ride has got a question, Dr.
Oh, may I make a brief comment?
Sure.
I think there's been an undercurrent in a lot of the questions and the commentary that was engendered by your really excellent and very understandable presentation of some very difficult topics. And that undercurrent is, I'm perceiving as a real sense of ennui, if you will, and almost bordering on fatalism in some of the commentary. At core, it comes back to what is to be done. And a lot of the comments have really focused on how difficult it is to figure that out. But one thing is clear. I think that the venues of struggle are there. The places where struggle can result in the working class, under its broadest definition as you presented it, can gain with organizing, with struggle, through struggle, the kind of consciousness that will lead to an understanding of the capitalist, how capitalism is really impeding the progress that is being demanded. These venues of struggle exist, and they exist in the places where the working class, the benefits that are expected by all human beings are under attack. Those are the venues. It's education. That is where, through struggle, working at the local level, working at the national level, on the part of oldsters like us, but you know, who may provide assistance, but through the struggle and can provide some direction, through the struggle, that consciousness that's going to be necessary to actually challenge capitalism as it is today will happen. And we can look at Chicago and see the struggles that are going on around education, and we can see the struggles that are going on around criminal justice, and we can see the struggles. I mean, there are all kinds of things happening in the city, including in the area of environmental degradation. I mean, the schools, we're having our children drink leaded water. I mean, they're all of the venues of struggle are all around us, and we don't have to really go looking for some abstract way of precipitating this process. We want to get in the streets, but we want to get in the streets around an issue or around, you know, the something that can move the struggle forward. So I guess I'm saying all this because I guess I don't feel as fatalistic about it, even though I myself am past retirement age, and I know that my role will be circumscribed. I do think that there's a lot to be done, and again, the venues of struggle are out there for participation.
Thank you, Milal, and I agree with you.
All right, that's it.